black hole to say that, well, nothing comes out of a black hole. But now we learn that black holes might be red if they are small enough. They can even be white, so we can even have white black holes. So it's so surprising that it even negates the name, okay? Now it's amusing to think what kind of black holes are white, right? So you can think about for a minute. So it follows from this formula. So how big should a black hole be in order to be white? Small. Size of the wavelength of white light, right? So such a black hole will look white. You can calculate how massive it should be. It's about the mass of a continent. And you can calculate how much power it gives. It's about a milliwatt. So you will be able to actually see it. It's not a very convenient flashlight. It's really heavy to carry around. Now, we have the second surprising prediction is that an accelerating expanding universe also has a temperature. So it's a very similar and related effect. So it's essentially the same formula, and the physics that gives rise to it is basically the same. So we have, instead of the size of the black hole horizon, we have the size of the cosmological horizon. And here we have the Hubble constant, or the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. Now, the first effect, so this is a theoretical prediction that hasn't been confirmed experimentally yet, but we'll mention that this one is actually very relevant for us. And this was essentially reviewed in the talk by Matthias. So we have the theory of inflation, which is a period of expansion with almost constant acceleration. And this theory, according to classical physics, so without these effects that we are discussing, produces a perfectly homogeneous universe. So if we were to map the density of matter, or CMB, in this universe, we will get something completely homogeneous, which is not what we have. In order to get what we have, we need some small quantum fluctuations, which were related to that temperature effect, or intimately related to the Hawking effect. So a main point, and if you remember nothing else from this talk, remember this point. Quantum mechanics is crucial for understanding the large-scale structure of the universe. So according to standard theories that we apply, that we use to describe the universe, we really need to use quantum mechanics to understand the geometry of the universe at the largest scales. Normally, we are used to the statement that, okay, if we go to very, very short distances, we have the quantum foam and so on that even Wheeler talked about. But we are seeing this quantum foam magnified at cosmic scales, okay? And it's amazing that the seeds for the structure of these fluctuations can be computed by simply following a field, or computing these simple harmonic oscillators with time-dependent masses. Okay, so it's given that this effect is so important, I'd like to review basically how it is derived, or the basic reason for this effect. So it's really a consequence of special relativity and quantum mechanics. So we can consider the following thing. So we have Minkowski space, ordinary Minkowski space, and we have an accelerating observer. So we have an observer following this accelerating trajectory. This accelerating observer sees, of course, a time-independent background, and he can also think about the notion of energy, which generates his time translation symmetry. And that energy generator is simply the boost in the original Minkowski space. So the boost around the origin in the original Minkowski space is what generates the time translation symmetry of this observer. So this observer will live in that accelerating universe, and will be accelerating. And we can take some particular time slice, and we can continue to Euclidean space. And when we do that, we find that this boost becomes a simple rotation in Euclidean space. And the most important thing is that this rotation angle is a periodic variable. And we know that if we are in a system in Euclidean space, we take our system to Euclidean space, and we have a Euclidean time direction which is compact, then what we are doing is we're considering that system at finite temperature. If we were to take that system and then continue it to Lorentzian time, we would find the finite temperature. And The temperature is just the length of this circle. That's the inverse temperature, 2 pi r. And that's also equal to 2 pi divided by the acceleration. And of course, for ordinary acceleration, so whenever you accelerate, so you'll expect to see this effect if your space-time it's a non-local effect, so you really need to be able to sense this horizon. And for ordinary accelerations, this is the temperature is very, very tiny. So the beta or the associated wavelength is one light year. So we're nowhere close to seeing this. But this effect arises because of the following. Another way of thinking about this effect is the following. Is that, so we've seen that this observer sees a temperature. This observer also, if it continues accelerating forever, will only have access to the right portion of Rindler space, of the right portion of Minkowski space, this right wedge, sometimes called Rindler space. And so that observer can only make observations within this Rindler wedge. And so he cannot have any access to observables on the left side. And what we see here is that if he makes observations only on this side, he sees a mixed state. So he doesn't see a pure state, even though the original Minkowski vacuum is a pure state. Now, this is the hallmark of entanglement. So the fact that if you have a system and you restrict, let's say you have two qubits and you restrict attention to only one of them, if that qubit is in a mixed state while the whole thing is in a pure state, that means the two original qubits were entangled. And indeed, the vacuum, the ordinary vacuum of quantum field theory, is a highly entangled state. So it's highly entangled in the sense that the entanglement entropy, if we were to sum the entanglement of all the degrees of freedom, we'll get an infinite answer because, as we saw in the previous formula, the temperature becomes infinite as you approach the origin. And actually, when you work it out, you find an infinite entanglement. Okay, so that was for just Minkowski space. Now we can go to the black hole situation. So we have a star that collapses into a black hole and so on. Now, the equivalence principle tells us that the region here near the horizon is similar to flat space. And it turns out to be similar to flat space, precisely in those. So it's similar to flat space. And if we stay outside, so if we are an observer who stays outside the black hole, then that observer will have to accelerate because we have the gravitational force pulling you inside. And then you'll have the same effect that we had in Minkowski space. This accelerated observer would actually see a temperature. And this accelerated observer only has access to a portion of the space-time, so a portion of the space-time outside the horizon. And because there's entanglement with the space-time inside, then we'll have, we'll see in this mixed state or finite temperature. Okay, so that closes the discussion of the black hole and the Hawking temperature. Now I'd like to make some remarks about gravity as a low energy effective field theory. So we have some effective coupling, which is the energy. So gravitational interactions grow with energy. They are proportional to the Newton constant, which we define as 1 over m Planck. Planck is expressed in terms of energy, is this particular energy. And so at low energies, this coupling constant is very, very tiny. And similarly, we can say that if we are looking at phenomena at long distances, we'll have a small coupling. And so these quantum effects are very small at low energy. So that's the same as we said in the very beginning. Now, this effective field theory expansion, as I said, works well. And we need to expand in powers of this effective coupling. And when we expand in powers, we find infinity. So the first diagrams that we can compute this using the technique of Feynman diagrams. And the first order will be typically finite. And the next order will get something infinite. The infinite is not terrible. Infinity is not terrible. We just say that there is some counter term we don't know. We add the counter term. And there is a residual coefficient that we have that will be one more parameter in the theory. So there's a well-defined procedure to remove these infinities, but at the cost of introducing new parameters. So at each order, you will have to introduce a few new parameters. So it is not a unique theory. It's not a well-defined theory because we have the freedom to choose these parameters. And if we consider processes at energies comparable to the Planck energy, then we will not know what we should do. So we get an infinite number of parameters and we don't know exactly what the theory should be. So for that reason, it's useful to have, convenient to have a gravity theory which has a well-defined perturbative expansion. Okay? And so how is that done? So we have gravity is related to having particles with zero mass and spin 2, so massless particles with spin 2. I mean, the spin is 2, of course, because essentially because the metric has two indices. Okay, so that's something we could have. Now, you could say, well, let's try to change gravity a little bit to see whether we can improve its behavior at large energies. So one naive thing would be to say, well, let's say we add other particles with higher spin. So this is one thing you could ask, or you could even ask, regardless of this, you could just ask, what happens if you have particles of higher spin? And if those particles have mass equal to zero, the structure of the theory is actually it's essentially completely fixed. In fact, we also need non-zero cosmological constant. But it's a weird theory of gravity. It's a very, it doesn't have the locality properties of the Einstein theory. So that's not quite, that doesn't quite reduce to Einstein gravity. So that was some trial and can be explored theoretically, but it's not what we want to do. So in order to get something similar to Einstein, it's more convenient to have all these higher spin particles have large masses. Not zero mass, but larger masses. And it's believed that this will lead to a theory that has nice ultraviolet behavior. And we really have only one example. So we have one example, which is string theory, which you can view it from the space-time point of view as the result of taking gravity and adding all these higher spin particles with some special interactions between them. We think that there are some symmetries associated to the presence of the higher spin particles, in the same way that there are some gauge symmetries associated to the m equal to zero particles, and that they have been Higgsed, though this picture hasn't been fully developed. What we do have is one theory, which is string theory, which contains these particles. And it's been developed over the years, and many things were understood about string theory. So the simplest presentation of string theory, the simplest way to introduce it, would be to say that we replace free particles by free strings, which are little tiny loops of relativistic string. They can oscillate, and different vibration modes of the string are the different particles with the different masses and different spins. And the lowest mode, so when the string is almost not oscillating, leads to a mass equal to zero particle with spin 2, which is the graviton. And the theory reduces to gravity at low energies because the fact that you have massless theories with spin 2 implies that you have a certain gauge symmetry, and that gauge symmetry constrains the interactions of the particles, and it constrains them to be those of gravity at long distances. So in other words, if we consider that theory in a space with a radius of curvature which is much bigger than the intrinsic size of an oscillating string, then this theory would reduce to a theory of essentially point-like particles, and as is the Einstein theory, which is a theory of point-like particles, where the graviton is point-like. Now, rather than giving lots of more details about how string theory is defined and how it manages to cure the divergences, let me make just a simple analogy to weak interactions. So let's go back to the theory of weak interactions a long time ago. So we had the theory of Fermi, the Fermi theory of weak interactions, which similarly to gravity had a dimensionful coupling constant, not coincidentally called G Fermi instead of G Newton, which was 1 over M Fermi squared. So that implied that as we go to higher energies and we get to this Fermi energy, the coupling increases, and we increase so much that it becomes of order 1 and the theory becomes intractable. So at lower energies, it's a low energy effective field theory that we can compute with, but at higher energies, we can't really compute. Then this was replaced by the standard model or the electroweak theory, where we introduce a new scale. So we have the scale of the mass of the W bosons, which is related to the Fermi mass scale by coupling. And then the theory is modified above these scales. And so we introduce a new particle. It's a particle with spin 1. And the introduction of this particle will imply that the interactions will remain bounded. They will not grow, and the theory will be weakly coupled at very high energies and leads to a well-defined and computable theory. So in string theory, the situation is similar. So we have this is Einstein gravity with the Planck mass and the coupling becoming large. In string theory, one says that, well, there are new particles at the string scale, so a new mass scale related to the Planck scale by the string coupling constant. So these new particles have higher spins, and they are such that the interactions at higher energies become controllable, and then one has a well-defined perturbative expansion. Now, string theory, of course, one of the main advantages from the point of view of quantum gravity is that it's a well-defined theory of quantum gravity. There are no ultraviolet divergences, and once you define the theory, you can compute to any order in perturbation theory. You don't need to introduce new extraneous elements. So once you define the theory of free strings, essentially you have also the theory of interacting strings, and you don't need to change any new rule. You don't need to introduce a new coupling constant each time you compute a new order in perturbation theory. So it leads to it's a well-defined mathematical structure that you can use to do computations. And it's a very constrained. I mentioned before that if you have massless spin 2 particles, you have to obey the background. The background needs to obey the Einstein equations. But in string theory, you have an even stronger constraint that even the dimensionality of the space-time is fixed. So when you consider this propagating strings, in order to have a consistent theory, you even have to fix the dimensionality of the space-time. Now, what is the dimensionality of the space-time? Turns out to be 10, okay? Now, someone would see this number and be discouraged, right? Because we live in four dimensions. But you can view this as an advantage because as Kaluza and Klein showed, so you can consider a space-time that has four large dimensions and then might have six small dimensions. And the six small dimensions could be an advantage because they can explain the rest of the forces. So they can explain all the other forces of the standard model. And since there are six dimensions, they could have all kinds of shapes. And so you could introduce many, many more parameters in order to fit reality. Okay? And you would also have the hope that if you find the result of all the other forces we have in nature come from finding the possible six-dimensional manifolds that describe the rest of the dimensions. Okay? So the idea is we have large dimensions and small dimensions. Here is just a circle, as in Kaluza-Klein theory, but there are actually six dimensions which can have all kinds of shapes. And so string theory also incorporates chiral gauge interactions, so gauge interactions with chiral fermions without anomalies, where all anomalies are canceled. An important property of standard model, but you can also get that with gravity. The simplest version of the theory has supersymmetry and supergravity, which is an extension of Einstein gravity, which you can view it as in similar spirit as this one, where you add small fermionic extra dimensions. That's one way of thinking about it. So you have all these other elements, and you get some consistent theory. Now I'll pass to the third topic, which is that in some cases we have even more precise description. And before discussing exactly what these more precise descriptions are, let's pause a little bit to discuss why we care about having a more precise description. And this has to do with some puzzles about black holes, and also because of the main motivation, which has to do with the Big Bang and the multiverse. So for these two points, we really need to have a more precise description. So let's discuss first some puzzles about black holes. So we know that black holes have a temperature. And even before we knew that they had temperature, Wheeler asked the question to Bekenstein of where they do obey the laws of thermodynamics. He had in mind the second law of thermodynamics. And we've learned a few things about black holes. We know that they have this temperature. We can use the relation between R to an M from the Einstein equations, and then use the first law of thermodynamics to get the formula for the entropy. And this formula was actually guessed before Hawking radiation, of course, as you all know. And we have this very simple geometrical formula for the black hole entropy. And the second law then comes from the classical equations and the positive null energy condition. And this explains the increase of the entropy. And if you include the entropy of the fields outside, then that also increases the generalized second law, which was proven a few years ago by Aaron Wald, who's here. I'm not sure if he's here in the audience, but he's here as a member in the Institute. He's over there, yeah. And the argument uses the monotonicity of relative entropy, which is some general quantum information theory formula. And the last few years have seen a lot of interplay of some concepts in quantum information theory and both gravity and quantum field theory. And this proof is a notable example. Now, so there is this wonderful connection between general relativity and thermodynamics. So the black hole, as seen from the outside, looks like a thermal system. And one can wonder whether there is an exact description where information is preserved. Right, so as seen from the outside, we see that the black hole, the horizon area increases, the entropy increases, but is there an exact description where information is actually preserved? And the answer, well, is yes, but we need to go a little bit beyond perturbation theory. So we don't know how to see this exact preservation of information within perturbation theory, either the low Brau approach of effective field theory or even perturbative string theory in the bulk. And so these exact descriptions, they involve going beyond perturbation theory and string theory. So string theory is defined as a perturbative expansion, as I've mentioned. And string theory contains some interesting solitons. I won't describe them in detail, only to say that they played an important role for inspiring some non-perturbative definitions of the theory for some cases. By some cases, I mean some space-times with given asymptotic boundary conditions. So in quantum gravity, you cannot fix your space-time. So because in a quantum gravity theory, you have to consider all possible space-times, and if you wish, sum over all possible space-times. But what you can do is to fix the asymptotic boundary conditions of space-time, because at long distances, quantum fluctuations are suppressed, because, as I said, at long distances, the gravitational coupling becomes smaller. And so it is reasonable to fix asymptotic boundary conditions, and if you fix asymptotic boundary conditions for some space-times, you have an alternative description in terms of a theory of matrices, that was the first one that was discussed, and also in terms of gauge gravity duality, which was developed by various people here in Princeton. So I will describe the second, so the gauge gravity duality, which is an equality between two kinds of theories, the theories of quantum interacting particles and theories of dynamical space-time, so like general relativity or string theory. The simplest examples involve anti-de-Sitter space, so as you know, it's the simplest space-time with negative cosmological constant or negative curvature. So it's basically like hyperbolic space with a time direction which you can view it as coming out of the screen. And the idea is that you have quantum gravity or strings in the interior, and you have the interacting particles, the quantum interacting particles, on the boundary of that space-time. So here we have a relationship between strings and these theories of quantum particles. And we know a kind of quantum particle theory that is related to strings, which are SUN-gauge theories. And this example, in many of these examples, we have SUN-gauge theories. So let me just review a little bit how strings are related to SUN-gauge theories. Roughly speaking, so first a rough picture. In SUN gauge theories, the Faraday lines, so the usual Faraday lines we have in electromagnetism, they become dynamical strings. So they become objects that by themselves can have some dynamics. Another way of saying this is that we can have the gluon, the fundamental particle. It's a particle with colors and anticolors. And in the limit of large number of colors, we can have formed chains where the color of one is correlated to the anticolor of the next, and so on. And these chains at the strong coupling and large n, they behave like strings, like the ordinary strings, the fundamental strings of string theory. And the string coupling is related to 1 over the number of colors. So that's some connection between strings and gauge theories. And I'd like to say that these strings that arise in gauge theories are not anything esoteric. They're actually observed in the experiments. So actually, we have experimental evidence for strings. In fact, this experimental evidence for strings is the following. So we have a bunch of particles that we generate in colliders. These are mesons. And what is plotted here is the spin of the mesons and the vertical direction and the square of the masses. And we can reproduce. So the important thing here about this plot is this linear. They all lie along a straight line. And you get them all lying in the straight line if you picture these mesons as originated from a string that is rotating. So if you have a rotating string, then you find that there is a linear relation between the square of the mass and the spin, where T here is the string tension. And then the quantization of the spin gives you the different values of the masses. So of course, this is very well established and is actually older than string theory itself. In fact, these type of plots were the origin of string theory. And I'm pointing this out just to point out that strings exist in nature. And string theory didn't come out of, some dreams of some people who smoke too much. It's solidly based on experiment and just trying to understand how to generate a theory that can have all these higher spin particles and understanding the interactions between these particles and so on. And so the strings of chromodynamics are basically similar, one kind of they're similar to the strings of string theory, and they should be viewed as quantum gravity in one more dimension. So so there is a very concrete example where we, instead of taking ordinary chromodynamics, we take a theory of supersymmetric chromodynamics in four dimensions. And in that case, the strings are living in a 10-dimensional string theory, which is a 5-dimensional curved background, 5-dimensional antisitter, and also an internal sphere. So here we see that very close connection between simply theories in four dimensions, which are a close cousin of the theories we use for strong interaction, and 10-dimensional string theory that we use for quantum gravity. And if we use this type of relationships, the radius of curvatures divided by the size of the string, which governs how well the Einstein gravity approximation works, is related to the effective field theory coupling. And so if you want this radius to be much bigger than the size of the string, you want the effective field theory coupling to be very, very strong. So if you want to recover Einstein gravity from these dualities, you need that to have a very large number of fields and also to have a very strong coupling. So they all should be strongly coupled. So according to this picture, you will get, we think that this might be true, that whenever you have a large number of degrees of freedom and they are very strongly coupled, they are very strongly chaotic and so on, you will have a dual which will probably be like Einstein gravity. Though this has not been proven, it's a floating vague conjecture. So the particles live in some number of dimensions, and the gravity lives in one more dimension. And the picture is basically that an object that sits in the extra dimension at different radial positions, at different distance from the boundary, correspond to the same object, but with different sizes on the boundary theory. This is another little picture. So you have the particles of the boundary theory. They are strongly interacting, and they generate, they can be this. The results of this can be equivalently computed by thinking about particles moving in the interior. And this can also be done for black holes, where we have particles moving on the boundary. And here, in order to have a black hole, you really need a large number of particles. So here I only had patients for a few. But so black holes are high energy thermalized states on the boundary theory. And the entropy of those black holes, which can be given by the area of the horizon, can also be equivalently computed as the number of states in the boundary theory. Now, the second computation is in general difficult when we is in general difficult when we are in a strongly coupled theory. So in a strongly coupled, it's very difficult to do. However, in some simple examples in 1 plus 1 dimensions and so on, you can actually do the computation and find agreement between the two points of view. Also, falling into the black hole corresponds to a thermalization of a perturbation in the boundary theory. So we are perturbing the boundary theory. That's the object that falls into the black hole. And from the point of view of the boundary theory, that gets thermalized with the rest of the fluid or the plasma. And that's it. And the description from the point of view of the boundary theory is completely unitary. So we are not losing any information. So we can form black holes, let them evaporate, etc. And if we are looking at them from the outside, we see things which are unitary, if you believe in this duality. Now, this connection has also led to an interesting relationship between black holes and hydrodynamics. So the field theory at finite temperature corresponds to a black brain in anti-de Sitter space. And so ripples on the black brain correspond to the hydrodynamic modes along the horizon. And the absorption into the black hole, so these ripples will fall into the horizon. And this absorption into the black hole corresponds to the dissipation or viscosity of the degrees of freedom in the boundary theory. And computing that viscosity, for example, corresponds to can be done by solving the wave equations in the background. And solving these wave equations is much simpler than computing the viscosity in the boundary theory, in a strongly coupled boundary theory. So this is a situation where Einstein's equations reduce exactly to the equations of hydrodynamics, and not only in general relativistic hydrodynamics, but you can also even get at low velocities the ordinary Navier-Stokes equations. And thinking about this was actually useful for hydrodynamics because it led to the discovery of the role of anomalies in hydrodynamics. So it turned out that when people tried to match the results that you had in the boundary theory with the results in gravity, they didn't match. And it turns out that what was wrong was hydrodynamics. So this is just to show that it's not that people are inventing things and they're matching whatever they want. There is a well-defined theory here in the bulk, and by doing the computation, you actually find things like the role of anomalies in hydrodynamics, which can then be applied to other systems. And in fact, so systems that do not have a gravity dual. So if you had any other quantum field theory with global charges which are anomalous, then you will have these effects. And in fact, people dismotivated for trying to search for these effects in perhaps heavy ion collisions, but they haven't yet been observed. Okay, so actually, the use of this duality has made black holes into a source of information rather than a sink of information, because it has allowed to translate strongly coupled field theory problems into simple gravity problems. So heavy ion collisions, it was applied to high temperature superconductors, etc. I will not get into the details of this, of exactly how it's used and so on, but it leads to some geometrization of physics. So it turns out that if you are interested in some of these problems, it's useful to start solving equations in gravity equations with black holes and so on in other dimensions. So the picture, one of the pictures that comes from this is this picture of emergent geometry. So the idea is that you have this exact description that lives on the boundary theory, and general relativity observables are well defined on the boundary, and the spacetime in the interior emerges in some kind of large N approximation or strong coupling. In some way whose details we don't fully understand yet, but they are getting better and better understood over the years. And this understanding reflects the work of many people in the string theory community. But we do not have an exact description of the theory in terms of the bulk variables. So we have, of course, the string theory description, which is perturbative, but we don't have an equivalent exact description in terms of the bulk variables. I mean, in the future, one might, one dream one might have is that one can go between the variables we have in the boundary theory and the variables we might have in the bulk as a kind of Fourier transform, let's say, so two different presentations of the same variables. We are not there yet. We are very far from there. Now, in the meantime, what has emerged is that there is an interesting connection between entanglement and geometry. So I mentioned a little bit this fact that Hawking radiation came from entanglement. Now, in these quantum field theories we have on the boundary of ADS, we also have entanglement between different regions. And we can consider here the blue region. And these little oscillating blobs are trying to represent the qubits that are entangled. And you can compute the amount of entropy that these qubits have in the interior, the entanglement entropy, by computing the area of a minimal surface here in the interior. And this is not true only in the case of anti-Sitter space, but it's true for generic states. And this looks very similar to the Hawking-Bekenstein formula. And in fact, you can view it as a generalization of the Hawking-Bekenstein formula. And understanding this formula has been a major focus of the efforts of many people in the community. So there is a notion that's been around that the entanglement pattern present in the state of the boundary theory can translate into geometric features of the interior. And the simplest manifestation of that was the formula we just saw. And so space-time seems to be closely connected to the entanglement properties of the fundamental degrees of freedom. And so a slogan might be that entanglement is the glue that holds space-time together, or that space-time is the hydrodynamics of entanglement. I don't really know what these statements mean, but they sound good. So, and maybe as an exercise for you, you can figure out what they should mean. Now, I'll give you one of perhaps the most drastic examples of this notion between entanglement and geometry. And that goes back to the Schwarzschild solution, which I thought was from 1916, but someone today mentioned that it was from 1915, December 1915. So anyway, so this is the Schwarzschild solution as presently understood. And the important property is that it has two sides, right? So you thought you were considering the spherically you thought you were considering an object at the center of the universe, and it turns out that there's a second universe on the other side, okay? So it's really a wormhole. And so there is a closely connected solution where you put those two black holes in the same space-time. You can ask what is the interpretation of this space-time. And this is the Wheeler wormhole. So Wheeler considered this situation. And he was worried because this configuration naively might say that you could send signals faster than light, right? So in this solution, if you can have two black holes. One is here in our galaxy, the other one is in the Andromeda galaxy. And let's say you can have here some person which is 1 meter from this black hole, and this person is 1 meter from the black hole. Their distance, of course, is the millions of years that separate the two galaxies, millions of light years that separate the two galaxies, while the distance through the wormhole is just 2 meters, okay? So one is here in this diagram, and the other one is here. So this might have the danger of producing causality violations. And of course, causality is the very foundation of general relativity. So could it be that this general relativity allows for a solution that violates causality in the ambient space-time? But it turns out that it doesn't. So it turns out that these wormholes they're non-traversable. You cannot send signals, and they don't lead to causality violations. So if you try to traverse the wormhole, you have to follow. You cannot move along a space-like line. You have a space-like surface. You have to move along a lie-like or time-like trajectory. And so if you go in, you end up at the singularity instead of emerging on the other side. So you can say that what happens is that the two horizons are touching at this point, but then they start moving away from each other. And that's why you cannot emerge from the other side. Or equivalently, you can say that the sphere collapses and shrinks before you can go through the wormhole. And this property depends on depends on positive, the null energy condition. And so general relativity ends up being consistent, and causality, macroscopic causality, ends up being preserved. Okay. So we've also seen that from these examples of the gauge gravity duality, we are led to think that in the exact theory, we can take a black hole, and when we view the black hole from outside, we should really view it as a system with a finite number of degrees of freedom, described by some set of microstates whose entropy the black hole area is counting. And in that picture, the claim is that this wormhole should be viewed as an entangled state. So a state which is given by the thermofield double. So it's a particular entangled state between the states of the microstates of the black hole on one side and the macrostates of the black hole on the other side. So what we are learning here, if you accept this, which there are some good reasons for thinking that this should be the description of that state. There are some constructions in the gauge gravity duality that support this interpretation. And the here in this case, the geometric connection that you have in the interior of these wormholes is arising purely from entanglement. So you can consider this states, but these black holes, but not entangled. And in those cases, there will not be a geometric connection. But if you consider them entangled in this particular state, then there is a geometric connection. Okay, so it's a connection between geometry and entanglement, or a connection between ER and EPR. EPR was this paper written in 1935. This is in March. This is in May. Okay. So apparently, he was thinking that they might be connected. As far as I know, they were on two different topics. But, now, of course, we said that we cannot send signals, but I like to explain what it means to have this geometric connection by considering a following thought experiment. So imagine that we have two people. Let's call them Romeo and Juliet. And their families don't want them to meet, so they put Romeo in the in our galaxy and Juliet in the Andromeda galaxy. Okay, they don't want them to meet, but they are very clever, and they share a bunch of EPR pairs, and they make a black hole in this particular, the pair of black holes in this particular entangled state. This is extremely hard to do, not claiming that this is technologically possible. This is just a thought experiment. So they make this black hole, and then what they do is they just, so if they make this black hole, there will be this, the interior is not a property of one black hole or the other, but the interior is shared, right? That's what it means to have this geometric connection, that these two black holes, even though they are very far apart, they share an interior. So Romeo and Juliet can just jump in, and they can meet here in the interior, okay? And live at least for some time until they get to the singularity. Now, the people that see them from the outside, their families just can't explain what happened. They just jumped into a black hole and committed suicide, right? And that's what Shakespeare wrote. Now, those are some of the things that have been understood, and the latest part of my talk was things that are that we're investigating and trying to understand better. And I'd like to finish with some mysteries. And there are there are many mysteries, but two very important mysteries that guide our thinking. One is the black hole interior, and the second is exact description, well, another is exact descriptions for spacetimes with no boundaries, and of course the Big Bang singularity and the multiverse. So these are all questions we now don't know how to answer. So the black hole interior, so there is really, this goes back to the thought experiment by Einstein of the person falling in an elevator, okay? The person was falling in an elevator, a beam of light, and the same beam of light can, in the falling frame, when you view it from two different points of view, you conclude that gravity affects light, okay? Light falls, as Brian Greene described so well on Wednesday. Now we have the same experiment, but at the black hole horizon. And we get really two very different descriptions. And the idea is that from the two different descriptions, we should learn something new. Okay? So from the outside, we see that the infalling observer really never crosses the horizon and becomes completely burnt by the Hawking radiation. Okay? So the person falls in and gets destroyed in this hell of Hawking radiation. But general relativity says something else. It says that there is an afterlife. So somehow it can go through and live for a little while longer. I mean, he will die again eventually, but he can live a little while longer after crossing the horizon. So there is no problem crossing the horizon. And we have these two descriptions, and we haven't yet figured out how to make them consistent, and the great lesson that we, but I think there will be a great lesson that we learn from making these two consistent. And it will be greater than noticing that light falls. It will be some very interesting connection between entanglement and geometry that we haven't yet discovered. But we probably are very close to discovering. So keep your eyes open for the next HEPTH, or some paper. Maybe it's not in HEPTH, maybe it's in CONMAT. So, and I emphasize this is exactly the same thought experiment that Einstein did. So that's one of the questions. And I think this problem should be solvable. We have some exact description from the outside. All we need to do is just understand what the description from the inside means. But as we saw in the example of Romeo and Juliet, what this person sees when he falls into the black hole depends on what her friend is on what his friend is sending from the left side, if they are entangled. So it depends, what this person sees when he falls in depends on how the black hole might or might not be entangled with something else. That will be an important point. Okay, the other thing that, of course, is very important is the following. So we saw that quantum effects were important for determining the long distance structure of the universe. And we have many reasons to think that these quantum effects become even bigger at bigger distances than the current observable universe. So in our observable universe, these quantum effects are very tiny fluctuations. But when we go to even longer distances, we might see these completely different visions of the universe, very, very different from our vision. And so the idea is that the ultimate theory can have different macroscopic solutions with different laws of physics. So in string theory, this can come from the different many solutions with different choices of internal manifolds. And if we couple this with inflation or eternal inflation, we could generate all of them. And even if inflation doesn't generate them, they could all be connected at the initial singularity through some quantum mechanical effects. Now, of course, we cannot see all these other manifolds, but the objective, these other visions are outside the things we can see. But what we would like to know is which one we live in. We would like to assign some probabilities for each of them. And in fact, the one explanation for the cosmological constant is the multiverse plus anthropic constraints. And in fact, this was a this led to a prediction for the cosmological constant, so we should take it seriously even if we don't like it. And we don't like it because we don't know how to make predictions, but I think the goal of the theory would be that at some point we'll understand the theory well enough to be able to calculate probabilities and to apply these anthropic constraints clearly. Because in order to apply the anthropic constraints, you really need to know the prior probabilities. We don't really know how to compute them. And there are several conjectures, and some of them are obviously wrong. And the simplest, well, from my point of view, the simplest way to compute, which would be the most obvious conjecture, which is the Hartle-Hawking wave function, is actually gives the wrong answer. So, and then people have tried to generate other conjectures for what the measure in the multiverse should be. And we don't really understand the theory well enough to understand these issues. And hopefully we will understand in the future. So another way of saying the same thing is we can predict the small fluctuations from inflation, but we cannot predict the values of the things that are constant in our universe. This is related to understanding the initial singularity. So I guess the idea is probably all these various different multiverses, different regions of the universe and so on, they have a probability distribution which is generated by demanding that physics is non-singular at the initial singularity. Anyway, that's some speculation. Well, conclusions. So we saw that quantum mechanics in curved spacetime gives rise to interesting effects. Hawking radiation and primordial inflectional fluctuations are two of them. Some of them, so the second is important for understanding the observable universe. And black hole entropy, black hole thermodynamics poses interesting problems of entropy, unitarity, and information. And the exploration of these problems leads to interesting connections between strongly coupled systems and gravity that go through other theories of physics that we know and love. And general relativity, so can be applied to other fields of physics, can illuminate problems in other fields of physics, like, for example, can be used to illuminate some problems in condensed matter. And patterns of entanglement are connected to geometry. Now, there are many questions we don't know how to answer. So how to incorporate the equivalence principle and the observer falling into the black hole? We don't understand the Big Bang singularity, and we don't understand how to compute probabilities in the multiverse. So happy birthday, and still full of surprises.